Okay, welcome. So you can take your seats. I'm Ricky Ruvez. I'm the dean at NYU Law School, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the Center on the Administration of Criminal Law's fourth annual major conference on New Frontiers in Race and Criminal Justice. For those of you who are veterans of these conferences, you know what important issues they tackle and what great panelists they get. And actually, very recently, NYU Press published the proceedings of the first conference. It was published last year on prosecutors in the boardroom using criminal law to regulate corporate conduct. And I know from kind of my perch that was a very influential set of papers and a very influential volume. I'd like to thank the center's faculty director, my wonderful colleague Rachel Barco, who's a Siegel Family Professor of Regulatory Law and Policy, and she will speak in a few minutes and tell you all the important stuff that you should know about the conference. I'm just a filler to make sure that everyone sits down before Rachel talks. And then you'll also hear from Rachel on the third panel on race sentencing and the problem of mass incarceration. As I believe all of you know, Rachel is one of our nation's leading criminal law scholars. She has written some of the most important work on sentencing over the last 10 years, and has also cast herself in, has basically started this new academic field of looking at criminal law as part of the system of administrative law and regulation. And that has been an extremely powerful paradigm, and Rachel's work has been enormously recognized for its pathbreaking nature. So she runs the center, and the center has done extremely significant things, including has written some very important briefs recently, amicus briefs, both on the side of government and both on the side of defendants, that have been cited and quoted extensively by our appellate courts, including the Supreme Court of the United States recently. I'm really grateful for all the scholars and practitioners who are here today, and to our keynote speaker, Professor Michelle Alexander, who's the author of The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. So it's a great privilege for the law school to host the center, to host these annual conferences, and to have all of you here today. And now that it looks like everyone is seated, it looks like an appropriate time to turn things over to our leader, Rachel Barco. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Ricky, and thank you all for coming today to our fourth annual conference. As Ricky mentioned, our center is an organization that's dedicated to promoting good government practices in criminal justice. And we do that in a variety of ways. We participate in litigation, we engage in public policy outreach, we produce scholarship, and we hold events like the one that we're holding today in the hope of getting a conversation started on an important issue. And we hope that these efforts will help change the law in a positive direction. Now, you can read more about us on our website, but I have to make a couple pitches while you're all here in a captive audience. So a couple recent things that we're working on. One, we filed briefs in a case that's being argued at the Supreme Court today on how to treat the ratio between crack and powder cocaine, the cases that are in the pipeline after Congress passed the Fair Sentencing Reform Act. We filed a brief explaining that when the initial 100-to-1 ratio was passed, no one really gave that any considered reflection, and we're hoping that that helps the court analyze how to treat those cases in the pipeline. We also filed an amicus brief that was cited by the Supreme Court and relied upon it extensively in the two recent cases dealing with ineffective assistance of counsel at the plea bargaining stage. And those were important cases where the court held that just because you get a fair trial, if you had ineffective assistance of counsel at the plea bargaining stage, that fair trial doesn't necessarily remedy the defect. In terms of policy outreach, we're currently working on a report right now that highlights the best practices in prosecutors' offices for dealing with wrongful convictions. So we're highlighting conviction integrity programs that work and work effectively. So I hope you'll look for that report come early fall. And We hope that today's conference will lead to positive changes as well. So before setting the stage for today's events, I do want to thank a few people. I want to thank Dean Ricky Revez for his generous support of our center, the Ford Foundation, also for its general support of all of our activities, and particularly also today's conference. We are grateful. The Public Welfare Foundation is supporting our Conviction Integrity Project, and so we thank them, and also the Manhattan District Attorney's Office for partnering with us on that. I'd like to thank the former executive director of the center, Anthony Barco, who's now in private practice, but who was instrumental in planning today's events and invited all these great panelists that you'll be seeing today. My assistant, Laura Marazziti, who has worked tirelessly to get this entire event running and running smoothly, I owe a huge debt of gratitude to. And the distinguished group of panelists and presenters, I thank you all so very much for the time that you have devoted to give today to this effort, and all of you for coming. So C-SPAN is here, and I wanted to tell you that just so you can be excited by it, but also if you choose to ask a question, you are thereby consenting to have C-SPAN air you on television asking that question. So you are aware of that, and you can decide if that affects your ability or desire to ask that question. So in terms of today's events, I've had several people say to me recently, what great timing for you that the Trayvon Martin story is taking place right now, because it's really bringing the issue of race and criminal justice to the attention of the nation. And while I agree that that very tragic event has been a wake-up call in terms of talking about race and criminal justice, I have to say it's a bigger mystery to me why we weren't already galvanized to talk about those issues even before that happened. And for all of you who RSVP'd before that happened, I think you had an interest in it that predated the issue. And the reason I think it's important to think about it in a much broader scale than that one incident is just the statistics alone should really call attention to what we're talking about. So we'll hear about more of them as the day unfolds, but I'll just give you a few. So there's more than 2.3 million people who are incarcerated and over 7 million under the supervision of the criminal justice system. And of those people who are incarcerated, more than 60% of them are racial or ethnic minorities. One in every 10 black men in their 30s is in prison or jail every day. Two-thirds of the people who are in prison for drug offenses are people of color. And those statistics, not just one anecdote that captures the nation's attention, it's those mass statistics that we'll be talking about today and how the different institutions of government lead to those statistics, what they can do about it, how we want to think about it. So we call this New Frontiers to address racial imbalance in the United States, because our hope is that we're going to talk to you today about the best research that's out there, the best of what we know, and what we can be doing about these problems. And we're going to start that with this first panel on policing, and then after lunch we're going to have panels on prosecution, and then mass incarceration and sentencing. And then our keynote comes at the end. For scheduling reasons, Michelle Alexander is wonderful to make time for us today, even in light of some personal circumstances that made scheduling difficult. So she's going to close out our event at the end of the day. And as you know her as the author of The New Jim Crow. And in that book, she says the book itself is intended to stimulate a much-needed conversation about the role of the criminal justice system in creating and perpetuating a racial hierarchy in the United States. And so this day is a day where we will immerse ourselves in that conversation. And to get us started is this panel on policing. It's going to be moderated by David Sklansky. He's a professor of law at Berkeley. He's one of the country's leading experts on policing. He clerked for Abna Mikva on the D.C. Circuit and Harry Blackmun on the Supreme Court. He was an assistant U.S. attorney in Los Angeles. He has served as the special counsel to the independent review panel that was investigating the L.A. Police Department's Rampart Division scandal. And he's just an all-around brilliant and wonderful human being. And I'm so glad that he's moderating today's panel. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming this panel. And I look forward to your discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel, and thank you all for coming today to join with us in discussing these very important questions and issues. We have a wonderful panel here this morning to talk about the issues of race and policing. Let me introduce them all briefly, and then we'll get started with the discussion. So to my immediate left is Lisa Daugaard, a public defender in Seattle who supervises the Racial Disparity Project, which works to reduce racial bias in the criminal justice system and focuses particularly on drug arrests in Seattle. To her left is Song Richardson, a former public defender who's now professor of law at the University of Iowa and a leading scholar on the role of race and social cognition in law enforcement. To Professor Richardson's left is Cami Chavis Simmons, a former federal prosecutor who's now a law professor at Wake Forest University and a nationally recognized scholar of police accountability. To Professor Simmons' left is Scott Thompson, police chief in Camden, New Jersey since 2008. Chief Thompson joined the department in 1994 and has received repeated recognition and awards for his exemplary service and leadership. And to Chief Thompson's left is Professor Tom Tyler, professor of law and psychology at Yale Law School, who is world famous for his pathbreaking research on the ways that policing practices and the conduct of other officials help to shape the legitimacy of law and legal institutions. So over the last 2 months, much of the country has been transfixed by the shooting death of a 17-year-old teenager, Trayvon Martin, in Sanford, Florida, who was unarmed and walking back from a convenience store when he was killed. Much of the attention to this case is focused on the role of race, not just in the shooting, but in the police investigation and the initial decision against arresting the shooter, George Zimmerman, or charging him with any crime. Last week, Zimmerman was arrested and charged with second-degree murder. And this morning, as we speak, the Senate Judiciary Committee is holding hearings on ending racial profiling in America. So, Professor Tyler, let me start by asking you, as a psychologist and law professor, what do you make by the controversy over the Trayvon Martin shooting? How does it relate to the longstanding debate about the role of race in policing?
Well, let me begin by saying that I agree with Rachel that we need to put this latest incident in context, and that context is a whole series of incidents of this type over the last several years, but really over the entire history of the United States. And this is just one example, but it's a good example of the tension over race and policing, both in terms of the degree of outcry, the prolonged nature of the public outcry about this latest shooting, and also the evidence of a clear difference in the way this shooting is understood in the white and the minority communities. That is, as was true with the Gates incident, which occurred a while back, when you do public opinion surveys, you discover that the white community and the minority community understand these events in really profoundly different ways, that the motivations of the people involved, their trust in law enforcement, those are really noteworthy, and they're certainly far beyond this most recent event, although that's a good example. We ought to ask, basically, why is there this gap? And I think the thing that we should recognize is that we're just looking at the tip of an iceberg. That is, if we look at national level public opinion data in the United States, we see a gap of 20% to 30% in the level of trust and confidence that the white and the minority community express in the police. Furthermore, we see that this gap has persisted over time. There's no evidence that the gap is closing. In addition, if we look at the entire population of the United States, we see that trust and confidence of the police is not terrible, but it's not great either. It's around 50 to 60% of the population expresses confidence in the police. And again, that is not increasing. If we look over the last 30 years, for example, we see no evidence that trust and confidence in the police nationally is improving. So we might ask the general question, why is trust and confidence low? Why is it not improving? And why is there this large racial gap that leads to the kinds of things that we see when there is an incident of this type, where we see vastly different understandings of the events and vastly different levels of confidence in the authorities to deal with whatever is the particular incident? What I would emphasize is that one of the reasons that we see this persistent gap is that we do not see that the strategies, the policies and practices that the police are using are focusing on the legitimacy that the police have in the minority community. They're not focused on trust and confidence. If we look at what the police are using as their framing strategy, there are two concerns that are typically addressed. One concern is lawfulness, the police looking to see if the actions that they're engaged in are consistent with the law. If you go to a police training academy, you see the cadets walking around with big manuals full of laws that they're learning so that they can try to make their conduct lawful. And the other is effectiveness. Police officers trying to do the things that they think are effective in terms of lowering the rate of crime, suppressing violent crime, particularly gun crime. And there's less attention to other issues, issues that, for example, in an earlier era were called community policing issues. It's really a very strong focus on lawfulness and effectiveness. The interesting thing about lawfulness and effectiveness is that these are not the issues that we find that people in the public are concerned about when they evaluate the police, when they think about if they trust the police, if they think the police are a legitimate force in their community. What the public is concerned about, and in particular minority community is concerned about, is whether they feel that the police exercise their authority fairly, whether they make decisions in fair ways, whether they treat people fairly. And when there are these incidents, we see that the concern of the community is often framed in terms of these issues of fairness. For example, in the Trayvon Martin case, an immediate question of consistency of rule application. Would this have been handled the same way if the victim had been white and the shooter had been black, for example? Is the law being consistently and fairly applied? What we see when we look at discussions with the police about a whole series of issues in recent years is that they're thinking about these issues from a different point of view, this point of view of lawfulness and effectiveness, and not from the point of view of legitimacy. When we talk about racial profiling, there have been endless discussions about when is that legal and is it effective. We talk about the vast program of aggressive street stops here in New York. We have a question of if it's lawful and does it really suppress crime. And most recently, mosque surveillance. We've seen the same thing. How has the government responded to questions about mosque surveillance? Really two things. One, the NYPD didn't do anything illegal. And second, an assertion, in this particular case with no evidence behind it, that this program of surveillance has prevented terror attacks. So the police are not really talking about the issue of legitimacy in the community as a factor that they consider in their policies and practices. And as a consequence, they're not building legitimacy in the community, and we're not seeing it rising. Because legitimacy is so much lower in the minority community, we're particularly likely to see low levels of trust and confidence in that community, and then we see the way that's brought into an understanding of an event like the Trayvon Martin case. So I would go further and say that actually the things that the police do undermine legitimacy. Because when the police deal with the public in terms of legality or effectiveness, they're basically looking at the people they deal with on the street as potential criminals, potential suspects, and they're focusing either suspicion or the application of force or threat of force upon those people. Communicating suspicion about their character, undermining relationships with people in the community, focusing basically on risk and sanction as a definition of the relationship between the police and the community. So I think the point I would make is that if the police would address issues of legitimacy in the community more directly by focusing on how their policies and practices shape legitimacy, and if they do that, they will discover that it's really a question of what people perceive to be fair in terms of the exercise of authority and principles of fairness, such as allowing people voice, explaining decisions, being respectful of people and their rights. If the police do those things, then they will really be addressing the underlying problem that's causing the kind of reactions that we're seeing in incidents like the Martin situation.
So, Lisa Daugaard, based on your work in Seattle, does it seem to you, as it seems to Professor Tyler, that the issue of race in policing is really an issue of fairness and legitimacy?
Yes. Who's next?
Tell us a little why.
So, let me just give a little bit of background about the context in which I'm working. I have the surprising privilege and opportunity to work with a police department and two prosecutor's offices, which are voluntarily choosing to discontinue techniques that were long established and I think have contributed to delegitimizing law enforcement among poor people and communities of color in Seattle and King County. And although the Seattle Police Department is currently, was the subject of a Department of Justice Civil Rights Division investigation and may be subject to a DOJ consent decree soon, these measures that I'm going to sketch out at a very, in an outline form, were instituted by reform-minded commanders prior to the DOJ investigation and independent of that, and this truly was a voluntary shift. we can talk later about why this came about. So what am I talking about, voluntarily surrendering techniques that have delegitimized law enforcement? I'll give two examples. First, those of you in New York are familiar with the program Operation Clean Halls and related programs that enforce, that are trespass enforcement programs, basically, where police agencies enter into agreements with private property owners to check and purge public areas of private property, privately owned property that's open to the public, of people who are determined by the police not to have business there. So in an apartment building, this could be a kid who lives there who cannot prove that he lives there, you know, who went out to get a carton of orange juice and is coming back, doesn't have ID, and the police don't believe that he really lives there, and so on. The NYCLU has recently instituted a lawsuit about Operation Clean Halls. Well, Seattle's had a similar program for decades. In Seattle, trespass is a transitive verb. It's something that the police do to people. You've been trespassed. It's so, like, amazing what happens to grammar when we do this to people. So anyway, for decades, the police department have made agreements with private businesses where they become the agent. I mean, on their own, they couldn't do this, but they become the agent, in their view, stand in the shoes of the private property owner, and then they get to determine that someone is no longer allowed to use this property, and then they're banned for a week, for a month, for a lifetime. If they come back, they're subject to arrest for criminal trespass. Probably more important, many people don't come back. They alter their use of the space permanently because they think that the police can and do regulate where they can go throughout their city. Similar programs have been in place elsewhere in the country, notoriously in Cincinnati and the Over the Rhine neighborhood. And so recently, and legally this is very problematic because this is a state actor depriving someone of liberty without any kind of process. And we could have litigated that, and we said that we would litigate that. But if we had, and if we had won process, what we would have had is a system where an individual could seek a hearing to determine whether or not they could be banned from the parking lot of the, you know, Stop and Shop or something like that. We didn't want that. People wouldn't use it. If they used it, they would probably not prevail. But this legal flaw in the program was a wedge to open a conversation with city leaders and with the police department. But what's remarkable is what the department did when we said, you know, we're going to bring this program down. Do you want to talk about doing things differently? They said, yes, they did. And they said that because there had been a series of highly publicized videotaped encounters between police officers and young people of color that were just highly embarrassing. And department leadership recognized that programs like this trespass enforcement program were contributing to that, and they took the opportunity to say, you could remake this program in court, but we want to remake it more broadly, voluntarily, as a matter of policy. So it has been completely revamped, and now police officers don't decide who can go where in the city of Seattle, or at least they're not supposed to. Implementation of this reform on the street has been spotty at best, and I think that is a very important question to investigate in any discussion of law enforcement reform, is translating command level decisions and policy changes to the street. The major work that we've done, though, has been on partnering with the Seattle Police Department, the King County Sheriff's Office, and the King County Prosecutor on moving toward unilaterally laying down arms in the war on drugs. And although we're still working under a criminalization paradigm, as is set nationally, law enforcement and prosecutors choosing not to file felony charges against people who have committed felony drug crimes, and instead taking those people directly to kind of a guerrilla social services intervention program where resources are provided to those individuals to address whatever the underlying issues were that led them to sell drugs on the street corner. It could be addiction, but for an increasing number of people, of course, it's a wage. This is a job that people can do and make money for rent or whatever other obligations they have when they're not able to access reliable employment in the official labor market. This program is called the Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion Program, or LEAD, and it came about after years of litigation that we were involved in challenging selective enforcement in Seattle drug arrests. Seattle is not only typical of drug enforcement in the United States, it is an extreme outlier in terms of racial disparity. It's the most extreme instance among mid-sized cities in the country over the last 10 years. And when we, where LEAD came from, just to wrap up, in the course of this litigation, we would win some preliminary trial level decisions, and the prosecutor would dismiss charges against our clients, and we would start over again and do it again. After a few rounds of that, we had kind of a sit down with the mayor's office, the police department, and the prosecutor with a two-part agenda. Part one was, are we all on the same page that there's a problem with racial disparity in drug enforcement? And the answer to that was no. The fur was flying for an hour-long conversation. There was absolutely no agreement, despite the fact that, as one King County Superior Court judge said, this question passed the any idiot test. Any idiot can see that everybody who's charged with a drug crime in King County Superior Court is black, even though it's well established that the large majority of people selling drugs, not just using drugs, in Seattle are white. But there was no agreement about what was really going on out there. But at some point in that discussion, a guy who I now recognize as really visionary, who is the head of the Seattle Police Department Narcotics Unit, interrupted and said, you know what if we set that question aside, and instead of trying to agree on what the problem is, what if we said that we were all, for our own reasons, interested in doing something different about drug enforcement? What should that be? And it was fascinating because we had no answer to that question. We had rhetorical stances. My favorite was always, arrest all the white people. And our ACLU partners were not thrilled about that position. More important, the more realistic position that we had thrown out was a moratorium on covert stings, low-level buy-bust operations that yielded most of the cases that were being filed and prosecuted. The problem with that was that our partners in communities of color were really not enthusiastic about this. By and large, they were not supportive of a decriminalized, and there are many exceptions to this, but they were by and large not supportive of a decriminalization paradigm because of a sense of not wanting to abandon the individuals and their families, the individuals out selling drugs on the street corner and their families and those communities and neighborhoods. They did not want laissez-faire. They wanted something. They did not want this, though. I mean, there was a sense of, if this is such a great approach to this problem, why isn't it being done to the white kids, right? And so what we tried to engineer with LEAD is a recognition that for the time being, the police will be asked to deal with these issues and problems, and to a significant extent, their deployment will be racialized, that this is a bigger problem and a more long-standing pattern than we can take on with this single policy change. However, could we reduce the harm of that police engagement and those patterns of deployment by making it so that when the police respond, what happens is not the beginning of an incredibly harmful interaction that destroys this individual's life, but an interaction that puts greater resources at their disposal to actually map out a realistic life plan that will not require them to sell drugs on the street corner to pay their rent indefinitely. That's what we're trying to do. There are all kinds of implementation challenges. And this model is obviously a very partial solution because it accepts things like racialized deployment and that police contact is going to be the mechanism that we use to inject resources into certain communities and populations, because we don't care to do that in a more comprehensive public policy approach that is not predicated on the criminal justice system. And that's all very problematic. So I'll say more later.
So, Professor Richardson, if the police want to build trust in minority communities and they want to be responsive to the concerns that Lisa Daugaard says have been raised by minority communities in Seattle, are there psychological mechanisms having to do with the way that people, including police officers, think about race that need to be taken into account?
Yes. I'm going to take Lisa's, but I will expand. Yeah. But first, I just want to quickly thank Rachel and Anthony Barco and NYU's Center on the Administration of Criminal Law for inviting me to participate in this conversation. So what I wanted to, in response to David's question, talk about is the ways in which race is discussed. So often when this conversation or when this topic is raised, we tend to focus on issues of character. So are the police rational, or are they racist when they stop African Americans or other non-whites at much higher rates than whites? Is George Zimmerman a bigot, or is he a concerned citizen? Is Trayvon Martin an innocent victim or a thug in training? These are the ways in which we typically discuss race. And what I want to suggest is that our focus on character and conscious racial bias may actually mask the ways in which we can still achieve racially disproportionate consequences, even in the absence of conscious bias. And so the reason for this, in my view, is based on something that I call suspicion cascades. And these are the systematic and predictable errors in decision making that occur because of the way that we all think. So I just want to talk about that very briefly. The way that our minds work, we tend to make associations between concepts in order to process information quickly. So you can imagine if I had to figure out how to use this pen every time I came across a pen, I wouldn't be able to function. So our minds make these automatic associations. So if you see the word doctor, for example, your mind will automatically think hospital, and other related concepts will become activated non-consciously in your brain. Unfortunately, the same things occur when we think about race. So these non-conscious stereotypes affect all of us. And there's research, for example, that demonstrates that police officers who think about crime automatically trigger non-conscious stereotypes of blacks. As a result of that, they pay more attention to black citizens than they do to white citizens. And this can happen even if an officer is attempting not to be affected by race. And in fact, if you tell an officer, do not use race in your judgments, that will cause the association to come to the forefront of his memory and affect his behaviors even more. It's just like if I told all of you right now, don't think of a white elephant. The first thing you do is think about a white elephant to try to avoid thinking about it. So just simply thinking about the concept of crime triggers these non-conscious biases of blacks. And the reason I only speak of blacks is because the science, this implicit social cognition research upon which my research is based, focuses primarily on the black-white relationship. I want to share just one quick study before I end, which is particularly relevant to police citizen interactions and judgments of criminality. So there's a study, it's a famous one, that where researchers wanted to test whether or not stereotypes would affect the interpretation of ambiguous behaviors. So they had subjects watch two men who were on a video engaged in a discussion that grew increasingly heated, and eventually one of the individuals, excuse me, Cammie, shoves the other. And the subjects had the option of rating this contact as horsing around, dramatic, aggressive, or violent. And the researchers manipulated the race of the pusher and the pushee to see if it would affect the interpretations of this ambiguous behavior, and they found that it did. So when both individuals on this video were white, only 13% thought that this shove was aggressive. 69% thought, though, excuse me, six, I got the, let me start all over again. When the two individuals were white, only 13% found that shove to be aggressive. But when both individuals were black, that number went up from 13% to 69%. In the interracial pairings, the statistics or the findings are even starker. So when the white individual was the pusher, only 17% found that to be aggressive. But when the black individual was the one who pushed, that number went up from 17% to 75% who viewed this interaction as aggressive. So you can imagine an officer who's on the street thinking about crime, which triggers these non-conscious stereotypes. His attention is going to be drawn to non-whites first, regardless of his conscious racial attitudes. And then when he's attempting to determine whether or not the conduct he views is suspicious, he's more likely to view that conduct as suspicious if the individuals involved are non-white. The studies demonstrate that this is likely to happen. The final thing I want to add is something called stereotype threat, because we don't actually focus on the victims of stereotypes, and yet psychological studies demonstrate that people who are stereotyped negatively have volitional or reactions that are difficult to volitionally control, like lack of eye contact, fidgeting or quote-unquote furtive movements, sweating, increased heart rate. And this is because of the fear of being judged or confirming a negative racial stereotype about your group. So you imagine when an officer approaches you and you are aware of the stereotype, you will uncontrollably act in ways that the police are trained to view as suspicious. So we can understand now how implicit or non-conscious thoughts or non-conscious stereotypes can explain the racially disproportionate stops of non-whites, even in the absence of conscious bias. So I think in order to deal with the effects of race in policing, we should engage more with the social psychology of contemporary bias and also spend time, like Lisa and others on this panel have done, collaborating with police departments to figure out ways to deal with the effects, the non-conscious effects of stereotypes. Thank you.
So thank you. Chief Thompson, let me ask you, Professor Richardson says that unconscious discrimination can lead even well-meaning officers and departments to police in ways that are racially biased and harmful ways, and it can lead members of minority communities to act in ways that the police wind up thinking are suspicious. Is that something that police departments can and should address?
Well, absolutely. Let me start by saying I'm going to relate to you my experiences that I've had in the past 18 years in the city of Camden. My city is about 77,000 population, and it's 95% minority, 50% African American, 45% Hispanic. Over the past decade, with the national rankings with most violent cities, we've never ranked lower than five. We've been number one three times. We perennially are one of the nation's most poorest cities, and when the state education reports come out, we again perennially rank at the lowest in the state with regards to graduation rate and dropout. So all the challenges, although we may be an anomaly in many regards, the challenges are in some terms even that much more exasperated with what we're dealing with. The issue of race in an extremely, especially in an urban environment and a challenged community, is it's at the forefront. If it's not something that is part of the daily conscious of an organization, its command staff and its officers out in the field, you are primed for a watershed moment at any point in time, whether it be a Trayvon Martin or some type of civil unrest. So, whether it's legitimacy and even with some of the things that Lisa was saying with regards to the enforcement aspects of it. It's absolutely dead on accurate. One of the things that we do find in our most challenged communities are, number one, that mass incarceration does not work. what we have seen in this, in the tactics and the strategies in the 70s and the 80s, the 90s, and even 2000, with regards to whether it's the low-level buy-bust operations or the corner sweep operations, it has not had a positive impact of either changing the mental calculus of the folks that are engaging in that type of criminal activity or changing the criminal patterns that are taking place. Fact of the matter is, when you're looking at a street-level drug operation, probably the most expendable component of that is the street-level dealer. But at the same time, you're dealing with the challenge of addressing the concerns of the community. And the community doesn't want the open-air drug market existing there because it's negatively defining their lives. And it's not so much the drug dealing itself, but it's all the issues that come with it as well, which end up turning into violent crime and the like. So in dealing with these aspects, and in some regards, when we're dealing with race in an urban city, an urban setting such as mine, the fact of the matter is we constantly see, and we're dealing with, even within our own officers, kind of the flip side of the racial disparity in application of policing, in the fact that when you have a densely populated minority community, and then you're seeing a tremendous amount of Caucasian individuals in high-end vehicles in a very poor environment driving throughout the city, it's the community saying to you, they don't belong here. They don't, go stop them. See that white guy over there? Go stop them. And officers are sitting there saying the same thing. They're making that deduction. That doesn't make it right in application in either way. But it's we can't be naive to think, number one, that we don't have an implicit bias, and it's something we have to address. And furthermore, I do wholeheartedly believe that there cannot be an over-reliance upon social control, formal social control, to have the profound impact within communities that we want to have. The reality of it is I believe that police should act as a facilitator, a convener, to kind of get that collective efficacy that we've research has shown us has been productive. We've seen it work in smaller segments of our city, but it's trying to get that and transition it into a much larger application, but all the while realizing that the solutions to a challenged community do not lie in a pistol or a pair of handcuffs.
Professor Simmons, we've been hearing a lot about building trust and operating in fair ways that elicit trust from minority communities. Is there a role for law and for legal institutions in ensuring that the police do move forward in these ways?
Yes.
And I
do have more. It's a common theme. So I just want to borrow from Lonnie Guinier and her analogy, the miner's canary. Some of you may be familiar with this. And she basically says that, like, the miner's canary alerts miners to dangerous conditions in the mine, racial minorities alert our society to broader issues. And I think this is true with policing, right? So there are some broader issues that we need to address with policing. We have a broader problem here. So if we can fix a broken system or make some improvements overall, I'm confident that we can make some improvements for racial minorities. And so to that end, I'd advocate a Swiss Army knife approach, right? This takes everyone. It takes the federal government, state and local government, and communities working together to address this. I have a little less faith, I think, in the role of courts, because when we're talking about the exclusionary rule and some of these other judicial remedies, these remedies can only affect adjudicated conduct, right? So much of what happens on the ground with police officers is unadjudicated. If it doesn't get to a court of law, that doesn't mean that it's still not a problem. So I think we need to have a multifaceted approach, and we need more transparency in police departments. And that will go a long way to solving some of the problems that the communities have with trust and legitimacy. So I want to talk specifically about the United States Department Department of Justice and their pattern or practice authority. The United States Department of Justice has the authority to sue and seek injunctive relief against police departments that are engaging in patterns of unconstitutional behavior, of which racial profiling is one of many things that police departments could be doing. And so one of these, and DOJ has used this authority in Washington, D.C., Pittsburgh, Los Angeles, and a lot of the reforms that have been gained through this, or the forms that the department is seeking to gain, focus on implementing an early warning tracking system. So if there, what one thing that we know about police agencies is that when there's a problem, there's generally a problem with a small number of officers who have repeated instances of misconduct. So if we can implement an early warning tracking system, identify these officers for retraining or retraining or discipline, that might help our department. And we can see how that would also, by making those officers accountable, might also engender some trust and legitimacy among the community. Other reforms have involved implementing a fair complaint process. That makes sense. If citizens have complaints about their police department, they should know the proper procedures in order to make a complaint, and they should feel some confidence that those complaints are going to be acted upon in a fair manner. And then there are also other reforms related to specifically racial profiling as well. So all of these reforms are really in an attempt to gather information so that we can have additional remedies. But the federal government, they can't do it alone. Obviously, the special litigation section of DOJ that does this, and they may have, I'm not sure the number of attorneys, but let's say it's 20 or even 50 attorneys. They can't be in every police department that may have a problem. So state and local governments are going to have to step up here and make some changes. And also there has to be buy-in from the local community. The local communities, they know, as Mr. Thompson said, they know, Chief Thompson, they know the problems in their communities, and they should have a role in developing, in identifying those problems and developing solutions that are tailored to their local needs. So again, I think the federal government can play a role here because they can incentivize states and local governments. There's millions of grant dollars that are made available each year to local police departments, and I would have the radical view that if you have a police department that has these problems, we should maybe withhold that money and see if they can't be brought into line. Or we could maybe do competitive grant programs and give money to police departments that have come up, have experimented, and have developed programs that are working. So again, I just think that we need a multifaceted approach that's aimed at changing the broader culture of police departments. And if we can fix some of the broader issues, then certainly we will fix some of the issues related to racial minorities.
So if I could just push back a little bit on this idea that we need a multifaceted approach and that we need to take account of fairness and that there's all kinds of different ways that we need to be thinking about this. Why isn't the answer just to say the police should not be making decisions based on race, and then to put in place structures so that we can find out whether that's happening? So this morning, the Senate Judiciary Committee is having hearings not just on the general problem of racial profiling, but on a bill introduced by Senator Ben Cardin of Maryland last fall, called the End Racial Profiling Act. And this act bans racial profiling by federal law enforcement, by state law enforcement, and by local law enforcement. It enforces that ban through suits that the Department of Justice is authorized to bring, and that private individuals are authorized to bring. There are awards of attorney's fees to victorious plaintiffs. It also enforces the ban by cutting off any funding for state or local law enforcement agents that don't comply with the mandate to end racial profiling. And it commands all law enforcement agencies to keep statistics, to gather data, so that we can tell whether they're, in fact, making decisions that are based on race for conscious or unconscious reasons. Isn't that the way forward?
That's it. Well, so there have been, this bill has been introduced many times. It has not yet passed, maybe 2012 will be a charm here. But there are a lot of states and local governments that already collect this information. About 21 states are under statutory mandates to collect the information, and about 25 states are voluntarily collecting this information already. So, I think a federal law is a good way to ensure that we have more uniform collection. The problem is, once we collect this information, what are we going to do with it, and how are we going to develop programs or remedies to end it? Because there are a lot of states that are collecting it have found, for example, Missouri collects information and found that black motorists were 70% more likely than white drivers and twice as likely as Hispanic motorists to be stopped by law enforcement officers in 2009. So we know that. We know we can look at New Jersey, we can look at Maryland, we know a lot of this information. But there are a lot of limits, I think, to simply collecting the data. And I'd be interested to hear what the chief says as well, but the burden on officers, and how do we determine a person's race? This has been another thing that can be difficult for some officers to do in the field. And also just developing benchmarks for comparisons. What groups are we? Is it that we've stopped more motorists in this area, and this is a mostly African-American area, so we've stopped more African-Americans in this area. So there's some challenges there. I think it's a good start. I think it's always great to have more information. The challenge is, what are we going to do with that information once we collect it?
So Chief Thompson, what about it? Would it be a good idea to direct all police agencies to stop discriminating on the basis of race and to keep statistics so that we can check whether they've done it?
I believe that the things that get measured are the things that get performed, and that if we are going to have a meaningful step in the direction of trying to address this issue, I am for this. In 2005, in the state of New Jersey, our Attorney General had issued a directive to all law enforcement in the state, banning racial profiling. Essentially, race cannot factor in to an officer's decision or his discretion unless it falls into one of two components. It's specifically giving in what we call BOLO, or be on the lookout of, which means that a crime has just occurred, or it is part of specific crimes that are reported in follow-up investigations. But that race cannot factor into the discretion of an officer of whether they're going to initiate a stop or not. Furthermore, race cannot factor into the determination of how that stop is handled once it is stopped. And the litmus test is, as Tom said earlier, is really, how would this stop be handled if it was a person of a different race? Now, that gets to be very difficult to manage that. What's key to that is that we don't have that directive operating in a vacuum, but we have that directive coupled with systems such as early warning systems. So, I look at it from my perspective within the jurisdiction that I'm charged with, and I'm 95% minority. So if I was to look and see the statistics of my officers, they're going to be stopping primarily minority folks, because that's the jurisdiction in which we work. However, I do believe that it is key with our early warning system. When we do start to get complaints of demeanor, we do start to get complaints of excessive force, improper search and the like, that now it does become a key variable in our analysis of what's going on with that individual officer so that we can have some type of intervention and either cease the activity, remove that officer from this line of work, or provide the training that may need to get them around the curve. But to answer your question initially, I'm a proponent to the axiom of the things that get measured are things that get performed. I think it's important to keep the statistics.
So, Lisa Daugaard, it's easier to measure the rates at which people are stopped than it is to measure the ways in which they're treated. So from your standpoint working on this problem in Seattle, which is the bigger problem? Is it disparities in the amount of times that people stopped? Is it how they are treated? And would a mandate to collect statistics and to stop discriminating be helpful, do you think?
I think that it is all about who gets stopped, much more about who gets stopped than how they're treated after the stop, because the stop itself, right, regardless of courtesy, regardless of procedural fairness after the stop, has done something to the individual stopped. It has communicated, as Song discussed, that they are a subject of interest, that they are suspicious, that they are somebody whom law enforcement looks at in a particular way. So it's not that it's irrelevant what happens after that, but the fact that young black men grow up knowing that they're going to encounter law enforcement, and young white people grow up knowing that they won't unless they're the victim of a crime or they're driving at an incredibly high rate of speed. That's an enormous problem in and of itself. I just want to signal, I think there are a number of limitations to this kind of mechanism. The first is, as Cammie said, the problem of benchmarking. Collecting data on what law enforcement does has very limited value. Unless it passes the any idiot test to any reader, right? Like, everyone knows that these Missouri figures are just crazy, but usually it's not so obvious. And unless we know the rate of actual offense to law enforcement, this doesn't prove anything, because the background facts may match their operational reality. Like, we're, in fact, you may under-enforce. In Seattle, when our project started, the Seattle Police Department were impounding the cars of people driving with suspended driver's licenses. When that law went into effect, we got the Seattle City Council to require that data be collected not only on the race of the drivers being impounded, but on the race of people being charged with driving while license suspended. Well, shockingly, it turned out that about 50% of the people whose cars were being taken were African American. But, so you might think that passed the any idiot test in a city where 8% of the population was black. It didn't, though, because 55% of the people being charged with driving while license suspended were black. Why? Because traffic stops are correlated with race, and not paying your ticket is correlated with poverty, which is correlated with race. And so the instance of driving while license suspended was incredibly racialized. So in fact, police officers were using discretion that under the law they didn't even have to not take cars of people that were driven by African Americans to a marginal extent. The point is that if you too crudely looked at that initial statistic, you would totally misunderstand the problem. The problem wasn't the way that this impoundment law was being implemented. The problem was the criminalization of being a poor driver in a society where driving is something that people have to do to survive. Anyway, and I think the other problem, so the benchmarking problem is an enormous one, and we have to devote more energy to creating a valid benchmark than we do to requiring police officers to collect data, or I think the whole exercise is sort of useless and can send people in the wrong direction. The other problem is based on race. I think that, you know, it is so easy to attend to the mentality, as Song talked about, of the individual officer, and usually much more important to focus on these widespread deployment choices and the incentive structure. So where are precincts told to emphasize? You know, not the individual officer choosing to go patrol down the street, but what are the areas of emphasis? What is, where are people sent at roll call? What policy directives have commanders been given? I think it's very important to bear in mind that police departments are floating on the top of a river of social consciousness and consumer pressure for policing. A quick example, so it's all of us, it's not the police only. Seattle, like many cities, has long done these undercover drug stings. Back in 2001, for the first and only time, the department chose to do an undercover buy bust at a rave, where almost everybody in attendance was white or Asian. And they, it was like shooting fish in a barrel. They arrested 43 people for delivery of ecstasy and methamphetamine and other serious drugs. And right before that, there had been a couple weeks of like press that the police had set up about how ecstasy is the new crack. Like, it's very, very dangerous. Anyway, so they made these 43 arrests. All kids, you know, most of these individuals had private counsel. They all had, they had no criminal record. They were from a good family. They were going to med school. They were all going to med school. And of course, they still are, because they got very favorable treatment in the justice system. But anyway, they got first-time offender waivers and stuff. But anyway, the point is, the department came to the Seattle City Council to brief the council on this operation, and they were just met with this firestorm of opprobrium. Don't we have better things to do with our police resources? Do you really have so many officers that you could send them to do, you know, this undercover sting at this rave? Are you kidding me? And of course, those are not bad questions. They're just questions that should have been asked every other day, every other year, about every other drug enforcement operation in the city, and they never were. So what did the department take away from that experience? They took away that there will be no resistance to the normal course of operations in Pioneer Square, the International District, Belltown, these gentrifying areas where poor black people are on the street and rich white people are in the condominiums, and they don't want it to look like that out there. That'll be fine, but not the pre-med students. They are not to be enforced against. So it's very, until we attend to that, I think it's very, very difficult to focus solely on law enforcement choices.
So, Professor Tyler, do you agree with Lisa Daugaard that a hard legal command to stop racial profiling and mandatory collection of data would be a helpful way to move forward, or do you think that would be a distraction from the issues of fairness and procedural justice that you emphasized?
I think we all would like to see racial profiling stopped if it, in fact, is motivated by racism or prejudice, as people have mentioned. One of the difficulties in the actual operationalization of these policies has been that it gets very complicated in practice because of the you know, there's a connection between race and propensity to commit crime in many communities and many neighborhoods. So the police, it's not as simple as just keeping statistics on the race of the people the police deal with. The police have very reasonable arguments in many cases that they stop particular kinds of people because of who's committing the crimes in the community. I don't think, therefore, we shouldn't try to do this. I think we need to recognize that there have been many efforts to do this over the years and that they've been difficult to enact because they get complicated really quickly. But I still would say we should do them, and I think what I would argue is that we should do them, but also we should recognize that to the people who are dealing with the police, irrespective of whether the police have a valid reason for stopping them or not, well, the first thing is to make sure they do, those people are going to react to how the police treat them. They're going to react to what happens when they deal with that officer, and it's true that being stopped can be stigmatizing, but we know from the research that the main way in which you're stigmatized is the way you're treated by that officer. So I think there needs to be training also for the police where they recognize that one of the goals that they should want to achieve is to build support in the minority community, something that the chief mentioned, and that they should always be thinking when they're dealing with members of any community, but especially the minority community, about how their behavior affects the way they're perceived in that community. We certainly know that when you have a civilian review board, the primary reason that people complain is rudeness or disrespect. And I think that's typical of what we find when we interview people. So to the degree that we can emphasize to officers the importance of building legitimacy and the importance of treating people well towards that objective, then I think when it's necessary for the police to intrude into people's lives, any harm is minimized and there's the potential for some gain.
So, Professor Richardson, can training address the problems of stereotype threat and unconscious racism that you were discussing earlier, and what would that training look like?
So it can. So there is some hope that simply because we are all affected by these non-conscious biases doesn't mean that we can't take proactive steps to address them. So, but before talking about specific training. I do think that in terms of data collection, I just have to say something very quickly about that. I mean, because we're in New York, I mean, we know that the NYPD has been collecting this data for quite a while now, and I think data collection is important. However, the actual behaviors of officers on the street have not changed. So data collection, fabulous, but we need to figure out what to do with that data once we have it. In terms of training, what's interesting is that I think that we all, scholars, activists, citizens, we need to engage more with police departments, because I know that I'm guilty of my own stereotypes about the police that I've had to untangle. And David Sklansky hasn't mentioned it, but he's written a fabulous article called Seeing Blue, where he talks about how our stereotypes of the police can actually blind us to the ways in which we can engage in collaborations with police departments to encourage reform. So one specific training that I will mention is that it's my understanding that officers are often trained to approach citizens a certain way, right? To approach them to gain control over the situation. So act with, one might say, aggression. And problematically, I understand why that exists, because you do want to take control. But on the flip side, when we're dealing with situations where we have communities who already don't trust the police and who are already concerned about being evaluated as criminal, the reaction of the officer itself can escalate the situation. I want to share one thing, though, to backpedal a little bit about this training, because, and talk about stereotype threat, because stereotype threat affects officers too. And what's counterintuitive is that it's those officers who are concerned about this being judged in terms of their negative stereotype, that they are going to be viewed as racist when they're not, that causes them to interact with citizens in a way, and there's a psychological study that demonstrates this, causes them to interact with citizens in a manner that actually escalates the violence of the interaction. And so there is a study done by a social psychologist named Phil Goff, who has demonstrated that stereotype threat of officers that affects those officers who are actually trying to do the right thing ends up in situations where the officer shoots the suspect more often. So I think that engaging with the social psychology of bias and the ways in which all of us are affected by them and collaborating with police departments to do that is the way forward versus acting on our own stereotypes about what the police are and how they act and giving them solutions without understanding the rank and file and management and on the street concerns that they have.
So we have about 15 minutes left, and all of you have been sitting very attentively. And one bit of psychological research I am aware of as a law professor is that it's easier to listen if you can sometimes ask questions and interact. So if there are questions from the audience, maybe we can take them now. Yes, ma'am?
There's going to be a microphone.
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm a former deputy police commissioner and executive director of the Civilian Complaint Review Board here in New York. And this question is for anyone. Do you have an opinion that might explain why minority police officers often exhibit the same unconscious biases based on racial stereotypes when interpreting ambiguous behaviors?
So I'll respond first. Yes, and I'm so happy that you mentioned that, because so often there's an assumption, right, that it's only white officers who act in this way. But these non-conscious stereotypes, we all have them, right? It doesn't matter what our genuine and conscious beliefs are, but we are taught in our society through TV shows, right, watching the news and the way crime stories are portrayed, we have this automatic association between non-whites and crime. And it simply doesn't matter what your race is. Now, there are these studies on implicit bias that demonstrate that whites have higher levels of implicit bias than non-whites have, but we all have them, and so what's important is how you categorize yourself in a particular situation. So a black officer in his community
might not be as affected by these implicit biases as a black officer in his role as officer, right? So it's how you view yourself in a particular situation that then affects your actions based on these non-conscious associations that we have.
I just wanted to add, because I think it's a fabulous question, we're thinking about, for example, what happened in New Orleans, the Danziger Bridge shooting. Several of those officers that were convicted were minority. In Los Angeles, with the Rampart scandal, several minority officers. I believe here in New York City, the shooting of Sean Bell, several of those officers, minority officers. So what we should be thinking about is, in addition to the implicit bias that's going on, is that these officers, they're still in institutions that can benefit from institutional change. So just kind of going back to my point earlier is if we can fix some of these broader institutional problems, these same officers hopefully can be affected as well.
Professor Tyler, do you agree with that?
Absolutely. I think that we tend to not put enough weight on organizational culture of police departments. And there's a saying that officers are not black or white, they're blue. And I think what that means is that as they go through the academy and then they come out on the street and they have mentors, they learn a set of cultural values and beliefs, and those are what guide their actions. That's what people are saying.
Yeah, if I can step out of my role as moderator for a moment, I agree with all of this, but I do think that sometimes people hear stuff like this and they think, oh, so it doesn't matter whether there are minority officers in a department. And that, I think, isn't true. And it's an important point to make because we've made a lot of progress in integrating departments along lines of ethnicity and race and gender, but there's still a long ways to go. There's an even longer ways to go with regard to integrating departments with regard to sexual orientation. And there's a fair amount of research that suggests that although people of all races are subject to the same kinds of unconscious bias that Professor Richardson discussed, it does change the culture of a department when you integrate it. It matters to white officers if there are black officers that they're patrolling with. There's been a sea change in the internal culture of police departments over the last 20, 30 years. Police departments are much less monolithic places. There's much more room for disagreement and debate and engagement with people outside of the department. And my own view is that owes a significant amount to the integration of police departments, much of which was carried out under court order. That it would be a mistake to lose sight of that and to allow backsliding or to continue making progress in the places in the country where police departments still fail to look in lots of ways like the communities that they police. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Some of what's been said I'm sorry. I'm Paul Cheveny. I'm a retired professor here. Some of what's been said, particularly by Professor Richardson, suggests that a law against racial profiling is...
Sounds like a rave.
Professor, you're being censored once again. We can hear you.
It seems as though law against racial profiling is hopeless because the police aren't actually racially profiling anyone. They are stopping people whom they genuinely suspect according to their lights and according to the lights of those of other people in society of all colors. So it would seem to me that the problem is to decrease the number of stops. Stop talking about that they ought to stop more white people instead of stopping so many black people. That appears, in the light of the research that you talk about, that seems to be a hopeless attempt.
And to respond quickly to that, I agree. I don't think that we shouldn't have this law. I think it's important to make that statement.
Data collection, I think, is important once we figure out the types of data we want to collect. And I think it's important to collect data from individual officers, because some officers are actually can overcome the effects of these non-conscious biases. But as a very general matter, when you look at officer hit rates generally, even across races, officers are just not that good as a group, right? These hit rates, which, and by that I mean your rate of success when you stop someone, right? How often are you correct when you assume that they're engaged in criminal activity? The hit rates are higher for whites. You're often more successful than with blacks, but even the hit rates for whites are remarkably low as a group. Contrast that to individual officers. There are individual officers who are extremely good at making these intuitive, skilled, intuitive judgments of criminality, and then there are officers who are remarkably bad. And the problem is most police departments don't collect the data to know who are the good officers, who are the bad officers, and then in terms of structural reform, the promotion process of most police departments are not tied to, are you a good and skilled officer in judging criminality, or are you not? And so I agree with people on this panel that focusing on police department structures and reform is really the way to go.
If I could just add, I think when you think about the massive street stop program that's going on now in New York City, where the police almost never find anything illegal on the people that they're stopping, it's hard to make the argument that there's a pretty sophisticated decision-making process going behind these stops. And I think you might argue that it's more just a strategy of indiscriminate mass stops as a form of social control. And to me, I think the point would be that we need to communicate to the police that they have something to lose by a strategy like this, because they've obviously figured out that they can do it in a way that can't be really effectively controlled by lawsuits or by similar legal procedures. And I think the point is to emphasize the damage to the relationship between the police and the community, and to point out that when people are stopped and they're not doing anything wrong, that this has a negative impact on their view of the police and their relationship to the police and the community, so that the police can understand that there's actually a cost involved here and not just see this as something that they can do indiscriminately, because why not?
I think it is essential that we move away from the question of why. I think it is possible to legislate in this area, but the legislation and regulation must focus on the very crude question of disparate impact. Mm-hmm. Title VI and its implementing regulations would have been a very useful way to get at this, but for the Sandoval decision years ago that took away a private right of action to utilize a disparate impact analysis for federally funded law enforcement departments. If this new legislation imports that, I think that would be useful. If it doesn't, I don't think it will. And I'll give an example. So we litigated for 10 years this question of selective enforcement in Seattle drug arrests. And as I said, it's about the most extreme picture in the country. We had lots of private grant funding to do this. We had an excellent sociologist working with us. And I think we established that, as I said, the majority of people delivering serious drugs in Seattle, including in open-air drug markets, are white. And almost everybody being arrested was black. But I can also tell you that what we would have been able to demonstrate had we ever fully litigated this case was that we would not have been able to demonstrate that anybody in the department, from a low-level officer to the highest-level commander, had any intent that that play out. In fact, they did not know. I mean, they would have told you quite differently that, oh, there's lots of white people being arrested. We would not have been able to prove that they prioritized crack enforcement. Even though 80% of all drug delivery arrests in Seattle were for crack delivery, although crack represented only a third of the open-air drug transactions conducted in Seattle. So the Seattle Police Department was addicted to crack, okay? But they did not... I've wanted to use that for so many years. And we ended our lawsuit and we started collaborating, and I've never been able to. But So they were addicted to crack, but they did not know that. They would sit in utmost sincerity, in a way that I could not dislodge on cross-examination, tell you that crack was not more important than powder cocaine, methamphetamine, heroin. And when you showed them these statistics, they would be like, That's so interesting. I just don't know why. We documented that there were white people delivering drugs in this open air downtown drug market. And after we published this ethnography, commanders read it and they were like, that was fascinating. I had no idea they were down there. We're going to go take a look at that right now. But so the invisibility of the exact same behavior conducted by white people, it was true. They did not actually see them as potential criminals. They thought they were waiting for the bus. Right. So we could show, using a disparate impact standard, right, the actual instance of the offending behavior racially, and then we could show who was being arrested for it. If that was an operational legal standard we could get somewhere, and short of that, if the question is why, I don't think it's a useful framework.
So, Professor Simmons, as a former prosecutor, what do you think of the idea that in order to deal with the problem of racism and arrest rates, we should ratchet back arrests?
Wow. Well, I want to say something, and I don't. Maybe we've alluded to it a little bit here, but when we think about the war on drugs, I mean, I think it starts there, right? So if we can kind of get away from crack cocaine and meth and some of these, you know, people that are selling these things, and we focus on violent crimes, maybe we will have some headway there. So that's about as controversial as I can.
So I think we have time for one more question. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So you mentioned that the Seattle response focused on how, dialed it back on felony drug cases, but in New York, and I assume in Seattle too, for every felony there's going to be 20, and here in New York even more people getting arrested for low-level misdemeanors with the same disparities. Has there been any focus on that? Because that massively criminalizes communities, people of color. It leads to lost employment, missed days of work. It's, I think, the biggest kind of civil rights issue that we have in New York City today.
Absolutely. So that, I mean, in New York, there's a policing decision, right, to categorize something that could be treated as a felony, as a misdemeanor. In Seattle, we've had the same phenomenon, but it's done at a prosecutorial level. Back in 2008, for budget reasons only, the King County prosecutor decided to file as misdemeanors a bunch of felony possession cases. But you only got the misdemeanor if you pled. If you decided to take the case to trial, it would be filed as a felony and not eligible for drug court, so you have to go mainstream. As a result of that, but most people do plead to the misdemeanor. As a result of that, we experienced what people refer to as discouraged officer syndrome. Phenomenally, the drug arrest rate for drug crimes, I mean, practically every drug offense is a felony under Washington law. Only possession of marijuana under 40 grams is a misdemeanor. So there's been a 63% reduction in drug arrests from 2000 to 2010. This is not the result of any intentional policy. This is purely an officer reaction to incentives and sort of the seeming trivialization of these cases by other players in the system. But what's been fascinating is, with the advent of this law enforcement diversion program, an ideological structure has now arisen that provides support for these officer decisions, such that what they used to scoff at and just be like, what's the point of taking this guy to jail? Now they look at you and like, why would I make an arrest for possession of a crack pipe? And they look at you like, that would be insane. I'm like, you're right, although you did it, and I cross-examined you on cases like that 5 years ago. There's now this like emerging, a really profound value shift and almost amnesia about, that would make no sense to do it that way. And I think that's what gives me a great deal of hope, is that there actually is, if we can provide a policy level consensus that there, and a community level consensus, that it's okay for the police to police these crimes differently and with a different outcome, officers are more than willing to do things that are more rational and less harmful, but the incentive structure around their decision making has to change.
So I think it's a great achievement if we can end a panel on race and policing on a note of hope. So will you join me in thanking our panel?